Hi. This video will be a bit different. It is what we in Silicon Valley call visionary. In Britain, we call it hand-waving. But before we start this, let's have a look at the phenomenon of emergence, when simple things at scale create much more complex things. We say that biology is based on chemistry, which in turn is based on physics, which is based on maths. What does this axis mean? Levels of abstraction? How about organizing these fields of study by complexity? Chemistry is the science of electron bonds between atoms and is based on physics. Biochemistry with huge organic molecules is at least one level of complexity higher. Proteins are chains of amino acids folded into intricate shapes and on another level. Self-replicating molecules like RNA and DNA are on yet another level of complexity and give rise to the science of genomics. In a single cell, all the mechanisms depend on all the previous layers, but are at a much higher level of complexity, requiring higher levels of concepts to understand. Multiple cells forming multicellular organisms bring us to biology with more emergent behavior. The science of all the things that can go wrong with the biology of a certain species, such as humans, and how to cure them is medicine and requires a higher level of abstraction than biology. The human brain and how it works is at least one complexity level higher and gives rise to psychology. How humans interact with each other is addressed by the sciences of sociology and economics. When large groups of people interact, you get to politics. The point I'm trying to make with this is that the phenomenon of emergence means that we can't realistically address questions for one level of complexity at a lower level. Please bear this in mind if you're a subject expert at a level in physics and you find this video series far-fetched. It's not reasonable to expect the periodic table of elements to explain proteins acting as enzymes, for example. So now let's look at physics and use a size-scale axis. At our human scale, Newtonian physics is a perfectly good approximation for the world. For a while, it was thought that this was the base level of physics. At larger scales and higher speeds, we need to employ relativity. We know that even at a galactic scale, observations and predictions don't match, so there is more physics waiting to be discovered. At smaller scales, we have the standard model of particles. My contention is that this is not the lowest level, and this is not the right place to search for a final theory. Instead, at the grid scale, there is an actual lowest level of physics, with the four requirements we laid out before. A number system, a structure, an initial condition, and a generating formula. The aim of this video series is to eventually present a candidate for all these four requirements. This is the fundamental and lowest level because we use the generative approach outlined in video 3. We're looking for an equation that generates the universe, not a set of laws. For all the higher levels, however, there are emergent regularities that can be captured in laws of nature. You will notice a gap. We'll get to that later. Let's start by very briefly surveying the particle types from the standard model that we need to cover. We begin with the force-carrying particles, or bosons, for the four known forces. The strong force is mediated by gluons, which come in 8 distinct types. Electromagnetism is mediated by photons, which have a polarization. The weak force is mediated by Z0, W+, and W- particles. The latter two interact with electromagnetism. No particles mediating gravity are known. However, there's also the recently discovered and incredibly unstable Higgs. The other particles are known as fermions. There are two quarks with the names up and down, the electron and the neutrino. And then there are three sets of these four fermions, often referred to as the three generations of matter. The thesis of video 3 was that particles are not tiny physical objects, but stable patterns of vectors in a hierarchical multidimensional grid. Although the vectors are defined as a mathematical sequence, you can look at this as a cellular automaton, which is an equivalent concept. Here are some stable patterns in Conway's Game of Life, the most famous cellular automaton. You can imagine giving different pattern type names and calling them particles, and then cataloging the emergent rules of how these particles interact. The vector patterns we talk about are more complicated than the two-dimensional Game of Life and not so easily visualized, but we still need some expectation of what they may look like and some plausible properties that can emerge from them. So in the last video, we speculated that time is not only multidimensional, but also hierarchical. The lowest structure that has time and space dimensions is six-dimensional order 4, with 3 space and 3 time dimensions. At the next level, we have 5 of these six-dimensional spacetimes with a much weaker complexity gradient. At level 7, we get 7 of these 30-dimensional spacetimes, but the complexity gradient is unnoticeably weak, so we ignore this for now. A pattern that persists down the dominant timeline, in the 6 base dimensions, this is diagonally between the 3 time axes, appears to the observers as stable. We show the dominant timeline as a fat black arrow here, with the 2 sideways in time directions as usual as thin arrows. For the next level of 5 dimensions, we need 5 of these timelines. Really, all the arrows shown here are at right angles to each other in 30 dimensions. For these higher 5 dimensions, there's also a dominant timeline, however, with a millions of times shallower complexity gradient. Here it is in blue. I didn't draw the 4 sideways in time directions for that one. Unimpeded, a stable pattern will go on for an unlimited time down each dominant timeline. If the pattern disintegrates a certain distance from the timeline, then that pattern represents a particle that can decay. If you remember video 2 about tunneling in grids, the same principles apply here. In the first 2 videos, we learned to look at quantum phenomena from the point of observer mind states. We know that the observer's mind state generally travels down this dominant timeline, but that there is a sideways drift. If the sideways drift of the observer enters a zone where the particle disintegrates, the observer on that timeline sees a decay. If this sounds too unfamiliar to you to be credible, there is evidence that this is in fact the case. Namely, the quantum Zeno effects works here too. If an observer frequently keeps checking whether a particle has decayed or not, then the decay does not happen. To explain this, you would either have to accept that the particle cares whether it's observed or not, or you have to accept this explanation that the determining factor is the path of each observer's timeline. There's more evidence. A lonely neutron is unstable and decays with a half-life of 15 minutes. But if the same neutron is part of a nucleus, then the half-life is radically different. In my view, this indicates that the neutron is not a fundamental object, but a stable pattern that depends on the interacting patterns around it. We said that the complexity gradient of the blue timeline is millions of times shallower than the one of the black timelines. So a decay by drifting from the black timelines is on average millions of times faster than a decay due to drifting from the blue one. In physics, these 2 modes are referred to as strong and weak decay. If we consider the six-dimensional space as being made from 3 complex planes, then the vectors of both photon and electron tumble smoothly in these planes. For that reason, we associate electromagnetism with order 4, meaning complex numbers. For a massive particle, that is a particle that travels slower than the maximum speed, the speed of light, we're looking for a pattern that curves helically back on itself. An example of this is the electron. When you have patterns that travel at an angle to the dominant timeline, then to an observer on that timeline, they appear to suddenly pop into existence and then to disappear again. These we call virtual particles. We are accustomed to considering an electron as a single particle, because at our scales, time appears to be one-dimensional. In reality, an electron is part of a complex, six-dimensional, symmetrical pattern. I don't really know how best to depict this graphically. Each of these electrons is connected to other electrons in other timelines through a web of photons. As we have shown before, when the observers don't have information about the electrons, then their mind states are identical and they can only make predictions about the path of the electrons, taking all the paths into account. When they do make a measurement, their mind states diverge and each observer only sees one of the outcomes. All outcomes occur, but to each observer, the measured outcome appears random. So that was complex numbers at order 4. Order 3 tumbling of the vectors is not smooth, but occurs in discrete flips. The order 3 equivalent to a photon is a gluon. In QCD, the theory behind the nuclear strong force, quarks have a property called color, which can be either red, green, or blue, or anti-red, anti-green, or anti-blue. It's possible that the colors are not actually constant, but cycle around, flipping between the 3 states. For example, a colored particle might go red, green, blue, red, green, blue. This way, particles that are far apart are pretty much identical, but when they're close, the phase becomes important. There is a nice and simple relationship between these colors and the 3-dimensional axes. The anti-colors point, of course, in the opposite direction. We alluded to this in the maths video about rotational numbers. So how would a gluon look like in this scheme? If a gluon spins around between the three states, which are equivalent to the axis of the three space dimensions, then there are 8 possible types of gluon, analogous to the corners of a cube. Building a helix in order 3 is tricky, since it doesn't curve back into the negative direction like order 4 does in the complex plane. If the order 3 equivalent to an electron exists as an isolated pattern, it would move at the speed of light at an angle to our perceived timeline, like a virtual particle, so we would not be able to observe it. It would appear to blink in and out of existence. In order to perceive it as a stable particle, we need to make sure that it persists down the dominant timeline, the diagonal between the three time dimensions. There are at least 2 ways this can be done. One way is to pair up each pattern with its exact opposite, so the sideways movements cancel out. The combined pattern corresponds to a quark and its antiquark connected by a stream of gluons. We call that particle type a meson. The other way is to make a pattern out of 3 quarks of different colors, also connected by gluons. This appears to be particularly stable since the combined pattern actively follows the dominant timeline. We call the particles that correspond to these patterns baryons. How about the higher dimensions? It's hard to make predictions about something that requires 30 dimensions to describe, but we can at least offer a possible mechanism for some of the weak force particles. So far we said we'd take all 5 branches of 6 dimensions to be identical. We can conjecture that we could change 2 of the 5 sets somehow, that the changes cancel each other out and maintain the stability of the patterns. Let's show this here by coloring 2 of the timelines in green and red, signifying a change of some sort. Because the 5 dimensions are interchangeable, these are not different patterns, but in fact all the same. There are 3 possible combinations. One where all 5 6-dimensional subsets are identical, one where 3 are identical and 2 cancel each other out, and one where 4 cancel each other out and there's just 1 left. So this could explain the generations 2 and 3 of the fermions in the standard model. If up quarks, down quarks and electrons are changed like this, we expect them to turn into particles with similar properties in 30-dimensional space. Neutrinos appear to pose a problem. They are clearly particles only affected by the weak force. As such, they cannot exist in 6-dimensional space alone. Neutrinos must be able to oscillate between these 3 states, called flavors in physics, and luckily they do. Order 6 doesn't create any extra dimensions, we remain at 30, therefore no new particle pattern types are possible at that order. Enough hand waving for now. We should also talk about mass, energy, charge, spin, and a host of other properties of the pattern types, but they will get too confusing all at once. I just wanted to sort of show a general vision where this is going. The approach we take to arrive at a candidate for the generating function is to try and reverse engineer the simplest pattern, a photon, then hope all the rest will automatically drop out. Finally, let's return to the gap in this diagram. We don't know the spacing of the grid yet. Let's assume the worst case and take it to be at Planck scale order. Each increment of the integer space coordinates corresponds to approximately 10 to the minus 35 meters. You see how hopeless it is to calculate anything but the simplest of patterns in the simulator, especially since we need at least 6 or even 30 dimensions. The size of a proton is 10 to the minus 15 meters or 10 to the 20 grid units. A snapshot of this at an instant has 10 to the 20 to the 30, which is 10 to the 600 vectors, each with 30 components. One time step later, we have 30 more of those. N time steps later, we have 30 to the power n of these. So, as appealing as it is to imagine 3 quarks firing virtual gluons at each other in 6 dimensions, a brute force simulation of even a proton is completely out of the question, never mind predicting the properties of higher order undiscovered particles in 210 and 420 dimensional spacetime. We need another physics theory at an intermediate level of abstraction to bridge the gap between a generating function at grid scale and the particle zoo of the standard model. And I speculate that this exists already. String theory was originally proposed as the lowest level final theory, and some string theorists were happily calculating the tensile strength of a string to demonstrate that it could lift a car. But in my view, a string is a turtle as much as a particle or a wave is. If you view patterns rotating in our multidimensional grid as vibrations, you see the connection. String theories use 10, 11, 26 or more dimensions. The string theorists consider these as space dimensions and theorize that the extra ones are curled up for some reason at small scales. Our theory has extra time dimensions and also a hierarchy of them. If you have many extra space dimensions available, you may get vibration modes that predict particles that don't exist. Our dimensional hierarchy is more restrictive. Six dimensions should predict photons, electrons, gluons, and up and down quarks. 30 dimensions don't just add extra flat 24 dimensions to this, but only provide a level of 5 dimensions that the basic 6 can vibrate in. My hunch is that this is worth looking at, but unfortunately I don't know enough about string theory to try and investigate this myself. Remember that the vertical axis here does not show abstraction, but a size scale. Relativity does not naturally derive from Newtonian physics. This is a more accurate picture of the dependency. Both the standard model and relativity need to follow from our generating function. For string theory, you will notice that the arrows reversed. String theory is not based on experimental evidence, so it needs to adapt to our generating function and its dimensional hierarchy, and not the other way around. Thank you for watching.